Hi, I'm Mary. I'm an environmental consultant and welcome to my sustainable food production channel. I've been working in the area of using organic materials, including digestates and composts, for food production for over 15 years. This video will consider the properties of digestates from anaerobic digestion. This will include plant nutrients, pH, electrical conductivity and dry matter, and how these properties vary depending on feedstock and post-treatment. A quick reminder of the anaerobic digestion process. Organic materials are converted to biogas, which may be used to generate electricity or be upgraded and injected into the gas grid. For use in agriculture, digestate is classed as an organic manure, together with animal slurries and manures, composts and biosolids. In some cases, digestate is considered a renewable or biofertilizer. I have videos on the storage and application to land of digestates and other organic manures, with a focus on reducing ammonia emissions. And other videos in this series consider potential uses for digestates. In the UK, there are regulatory controls in place for digestates derived from food wastes and other animal byproducts to ensure their safety. More about this in my digestate regulations video. And now on to today's topic, digestate. In some countries, digestate is called biogas residue. Digestate is nutrient-rich liquid, and it contains valuable quantities of NPK, magnesium sulfur, and also trace elements, which can replace conventional fertilisers. Feedstock of anaerobic digesters is often consistent for that specific digester, but will be different to other digesters. For example, some sites process municipal food waste, others vegetable processing residues, animal slurries, manures or purpose-grown crops. Some will use a mixture of different feedstocks. These feedstocks have a range of physical and chemical properties, and so the resultant digestate properties will vary depending on the feedstock and the anaerobic digestion process itself. In some anaerobic digestion plants, the digestate produced is left whole. This is generally 3 to 10% dry matter. In others, the digestate is separated into a liquid and a solid fraction, with an example of a screw press separator shown in the middle photo. The separated liquid fraction is called liquor and is often 1 to 6% dry matter. The solid fraction is called fibre and is typically 18 to 40% dry matter. When digestates are separated, phosphorus tends to bind to the organic matter and therefore ends up in the fibre fraction. So liquor digestates generally contain less phosphate. Potassium and nitrogen are both water-soluble and therefore predominantly end up in the liquid fraction, although there will be some in the solid fibre as well. So when thinking about the potential end use, it's important to know the nutrient content of the digestate. Firstly, thinking about pH. A pH of digestates tends to be above neutral, with a range of generally between 7.3 and 9. With electrical conductivity, however, this is much more variable. This graph shows just how variable digestate electrical conductivity is. Food waste-based digestates are shown in the blue triangle. Generally, these have a higher conductivity than crop and manure-based digestates, which are shown on the right-hand side of the graph. So the food waste digestates tend to have a higher salt content, and so therefore have a higher conductivity. The three digestates on the right are fibre digestates, and they also show a big range in electrical conductivity. In my videos where I discuss scientific research on whether digestates could be used in horticulture, the conductivity is something that the researchers consider to be important to know. Now on to nutrients. Firstly, let's think about nitrogen. Digestates contain mineral nitrogen, mostly as ammonium, with a very small amount of nitrate, if any. So these forms of nitrogen are readily available and can be taken up rapidly by the crop. Digestates also contain organic nitrogen, which once applied to land takes longer to break down in the soil. I have a separate video on the soil nitrogen cycle, following what happens when digestates and other organic manures are applied to land. Here is an example of the nitrogen content of 10 different liquid digestates, all from different anaerobic digestion sites in the UK, as we saw in the last graph. W is for whole digestates and L is separated liquor. This shows that for the majority of digestates, the mineral nitrogen as ammonium, which is the green bar, is the main source of nitrogen. The orange bar is the organic nitrogen. The whole food waste digestates are on the left in the blue rectangle. This shows that the nitrogen content varies considerably even between different digesters all processing food wastes. You can see how the total organic nitrogen and the ammonium vary in both total amount and the proportion in each digestate. The two digestates on the right were both produced from maize, and about half of their nitrogen is organic nitrogen. For all the other digestates, ammonium is over 75% of the total nitrogen. Here we see that whole and separated liquor digestates contain useful plant nutrients in variable amounts. The nutrients contained in the feedstock will generally be in the same proportions as the resultant digestate. So what comes in, comes out. The top row shows the range of four different food waste digestates, the same ones that we saw in the graphs earlier. The total amount of the nutrients are shown here. The amount available to the crop following application will vary, with generally at least half of the phosphate and a bit more of the potassium being available. Calcium, magnesium and sulphur are also important plant nutrients and are contained in the digestates. Sodium, shown on the right, is much higher in the food waste digestates due to the salt content within the food. We saw this shown in the electrical conductivity just now. Here are a few results of digestate fibre. The dry matter content of these fibres was around 18 to 24%. The results are variable, but do show that the fibre also contains all of the main plant macronutrients. The amount of PK and sulphur and some other nutrients in the digestate may be sufficient for the crop. Digestates tend to be analysed for micronutrients less often. Where analysed, micronutrients are present in digestates in smaller quantities than the macronutrients. Micronutrients are also sometimes applied to crops by farmers where deficiencies are around. Here is an example of the available micronutrients in five liquid digestates. This shows that they all contain boron, copper, iron, manganese and zinc in variable quantities. Using digestate is similar to using any other bulky organic material. It's important to understand its chemical and physical properties, and to choose appropriate storage and application techniques to minimise nutrient losses. Knowing how much nitrogen is readily available as ammonium, plus the other nutrients, especially phosphorus, potassium and sulphur, can help with nutrient planning. When planning to use digestates, it's important to calculate the fertiliser replacement value or ask a FACTS qualified advisor to do this for you, to be sure to spread the right amount at the right time for each crop. This slide shows the fertiliser value of a digestate. The top row shows the content of available nitrogen as ammonium and also available potash and phosphate as an example digestate. By multiplying these numbers with the market price of fertilisers, we come to a value of 381 per tonne of digestate. Consider the digestate is applied at a rate of 40 tonnes per hectare. This would value the digestate available NP and K at just over £150. And there is also the additional organic nitrogen and range of other nutrients to consider. These figures were correct for June 2020. For up-to-date figures, you can check out the RAP Compost Calculator webpage. And in summary, the pH of digestates is slightly alkaline and the electrical conductivity is quite variable, generally higher with food waste feedstocks. Digestates contain a range of valuable plant nutrients, and the quantity depends on the feedstock and the process, and includes whether the digestate remains whole or is separated. Here are some useful links to the information that I used to create this video. And finally, I am planning some more videos in this Use of Digestate series, including scientific research on whether digestates can be used in horticulture. I also have videos on storage of digestates and application to agricultural land, which is part of my Reducing Ammonia Emissions from Organic Manure series. Let me know what you think of this video today and what topics you feel would be useful. Thank you for listening.